Oh, hello. Okay, so I just discovered I had the mic open all that time during the startup. This is a different kind of live stream for me, a different kind of video, and calling it something along the lines of, what did I label this one? Live lab work, PC wipe and reload, and miscellaneous. So I have some things to do for clients this afternoon. It's billable work, but it dawned on me that this might be suitable for a live stream, so I'm just gonna try it and see how it goes. And since I didn't have this set up early, I only did the thumbnail about 4 minutes before clicking to go live and schedule this. And I do see there's eight people there. Harambe says the mic was off. Oh, yes, it was off. You're right. Because when I push the buttons on my stream deck, I push the button to unmute the microphone. So, yes, it was off. Although I'm not quite sure how you knew that, but that's great. So, I'm still kind of getting a little bit of this set up for what I want to do. So here I'm going to take the watch off and let's take care of the basics first. Stream settings, turn the DVR on. So we're ready for an AVDW check. That took care of the W. I see the video is streaming. And I have it monitoring over here, and that is muted. I see Tim Sal, Harambe, and Tony Wallow, and Ada Rivera. I don't know why I think I'm pronouncing Harambe correctly, but maybe you can tell me I'm close enough or correct me on that. But that just seems to be how I want to pronounce it. And Ada says AVD is good, and here's Gary. Sound looks good, sync is good, and Gary has my cell phone number, so you can bring my attention to anything that's needed. Let's get the cell phone plugged in over here. So I've kind of done a really quick setup for this, and I'm gonna repeat in a few minutes what the idea is behind this video. I already said it once, but I'm not sure that there were any viewers at that time. And you know what? I'm kind of tempted. I still have Zoom open. So I'm going to turn the Zoom session on. If anyone is inclined to come in, you're welcome to do that because I don't have anyone that I'm actually providing support to during this video. I'm actually going to be doing some billable work for my clients during this time and handling anything that comes up along the way or in chat. So you might kind of think of this as tech tales enhanced, meaning instead of telling about the work, I'm actually going to do the work on camera because I think I have this a few different tasks for clients in mind that I can do without exposing my clients. Harambe says it's correct, like the famous gorilla. Well, that would be great if I was familiar with the gorilla. I have to claim ignorance to that, I guess. And Jeff says good afternoon from Las Vegas. And good afternoon to you as well, Jeff. Let's pop out chat. Let's see, I guess I can do this piece here, and that's going to start doing picture in picture, unless I get it covered up. And is that going to be all right? Yeah, I think so. How about zooming in a bit on chat? I did that with Control Plus. Scroll down here. Blackwatch, is it playtime yet? Yes, it is. So let's see, I'm seeing nine concurrent viewers. What else do I need to do by way of setup before I go over the plan again? Let me see if I do this scene transition here. What does that put me? Yeah, that's all right. So when I've got the chat on computer number two, which is that computer, my streamer is showing what I'm sending out over the wire, and I can actually read chat straight ahead of me when I'm looking towards the camera. So that kind of works. Let's position this a little bit more. This is the first video in this particular style of video for me. So I'm actually going to be doing billable client work during this video. I probably won't be as productive with it as I would if I weren't doing a video, or maybe I'll be more productive because I won't get distracted. I don't know. Z Manor, hi. Jeff asks, what can you say again what kind of video cams you use? I can't find the other video in which you told me. Certainly. Here's, they are all Logitech C920 webcams. That's what they look like. This is just mounted on a clamping style so I can clamp on the desk here. And if I actually put this camera on video, you see I've got two cameras up there and I've got one camera over here. So these on my monitor, the one on the right is the one that I call camera one. The one on the left is the camera that's used for Zoom. I don't use the same camera for Zoom as what I use for camera one because the two programs can't share the camera. There is a way to make them share the camera, and I have tried that, and it puts too much extra load on my streaming computer. And also it makes the sound out of sync with the lips. So two cameras. And I have the Zoom session turned on. I need to put those credentials somewhere just in case somebody wants to come on. If you want to come on and interact, you can do it with your camera off or on. That's up to you. And so I just copied the Zoom invitation to the clipboard on my on my computer number one. So now I go over here to computer number two and use Windows key V to get my clipboard history, and then click to paste that. Now, we don't need all of that. We just need the link. And if I can pick out the link from that, it looks like right there. And then come back to here, join Zoom meeting. If I delete that part. So that should get you a clickable link if somebody wants to come in. Gary, less than 10 billable hours for the client, please, unless you don't like the client or it's for the attorney. So I was thinking that I am going to do start and stop times in my time slips, but then I'm going to put in a break time increment to estimate the amount of time that I don't think is chargeable to them so that I wind up charging them appropriate. And if you think for a minute that I'm double dipping in the sense of being able to create YouTube videos that I may eventually make money on and bill my client for that time at all, then congratulations, you're right. There's nothing wrong with doing that. Sounds like a good, smart business idea for me. I just need to not expose anything about the client or about the clients that I'm involved with or working on. And so this makes me comparable to what Jessa Jones does on iPad Rehab or Lewis. Oh, come on. How am I forgetting his name? I know his name. The other iPhone guy. Because they're doing billable work on camera and live streaming it. And so if I have an opportunity to be billing a client and making videos that I may eventually make money on, go for it, in my mind. So I'm caught up there. Lewis Rossman. Thank you, Jeff. Yep, absolutely. And this is just kind of a recent idea. Actually, because of these computers right here, this is what got me the notion just within the last couple of days that I might be able to pull this off, meaning do live stream while doing actual billable work. And when I started thinking about the details of how to do this, it occurred to me that I may be able to do some other live work this way too. So part of what I'll be doing is depending on how far along I get with the things that I have in mind, I may be connecting remotely to clients' actual computers on this computer, but I'm going to show you this view of it so that you're not going to be able to read anything that's on their screens. Or I might give you this kind of view of it. That's a blurred view of that screen. And I'm kind of thinking that it may be enough of an understanding for you to know what I'm doing along with my explanations of what I'm doing. So when I get to places with this computer that it needs to run for a period of time, that's when I can turn to this computer and do some of the remote work that I have in mind doing today. So I've got a client at the chiropractor office that I've told you about that I copied some files off of her old computer. That's the one that I referred to as the TC experiment in some videos. And it's the computer that has the cryptographic services. Comes up once in a while, makes the computer really sluggish. So I have that computer. It still has that sickness to it. And I have yet to bring it back up on the desk to try to resolve that. Now, these computers, one of these computers had that same cryptographic services. And you saw me in a recent live stream video where I was it would have been with Ken Stout. And I showed a couple times that I was connected remotely to two of these computers running the emergency repair tool. And one of those computers has this same cryptographic services problem. I don't think it's this one, but it's kind of irrelevant which one of these have it, because I'm not gonna go after that problem on these computers. I mentioned in that video that I have five infected computers, or five.
Ooh, that's a lot.
It wasn't with Ken Stout. It was the Windows 11. Yeah, it was the Windows 11 live stream. That's when I showed these computers. And I told you I had five computers I need to bring in here because they were all mucked up from, you know, this freeware stuff that people install. Mm-hmm. And it's all five of these computers have been used by the public, the residents of the apartment buildings that I report about often. So I have five of these computers here right now. The other four are in the other room. And my plan for them is to wipe and reload on one of them and get it set up the way that I want, and then make an image backup of that and restore it to the other computer. So this is five computers from two different apartment buildings. Taking a look back at chat. Yesterday, Ken Stout told us during Carrie live stream that he was very pleased with the installation of his new computer. Marvelous. installation of it, well, the build of his new computer. Awesome. And Gary says, I darn well agree with you. The attorney bills two clients for the same info at the same time. Been there, done that. Yeah. And Doug put it in Hebrew. Then only a couple of us can read it. Sure. Awesome. Okay. So let's see. I guess I could have just bounced over like this, right? And then if I do this scene transition there, that makes that even more visible. So what I'm figuring I'm going to start with is this computer to do a fresh install of Windows 10 using the current ISO. So I'm actually going to download the file, put it on a memory stick, and do it and do it here. Z-Man are awesome. You're showing us a little bit of Hebrew there.
Wait.
Let's see. So Tim just sent me a text. Sounds like I'm hearing someone talking in your Zoom meeting. I have Zoom on. Let's see here. But there's nobody in there.
Hello?
Is anybody else hearing extra voices?
It's me.
So that's the Zoom message there. I mean, the Zoom video there. And if I come back to that, so that's the camera on the left. I can put my hand over it like that. And then my camera on the one, if I put my hand over the Zoom camera, you don't see it. There's my hand over the broadcast camera. I heard someone say hello again, Tim says.
Hello.
How can that be? Is somebody yelling really loud in chat and Tim's hearing it?
Hello, this is Darwin.
Let's see. Ada says she's hearing someone else. Darren, me. I thought Top Fuel Mills created that chit-chat. I hear them. I'm hearing someone say, hello, this is Dolly. Blackwatch says someone's going hello Dougie. I'm hearing things too. They're saying hello. Yeah, we have ghosts. Do I have a YouTube video playing somewhere?
It is green.
I've got the sound muted on that one. This one's not playing a video at all.
I'm in the link.
Tab to check on that. Let's see. No, not that way. This way. So that's my computer number 3. It's not playing any videos. Computer number 2 is playing the video that you're watching right now. See here? But it's got the speaker muted. Bring the chat back up on top of that video so it stops doing that infinite mirror. And how about my streamer computer?
Hello.
What's it doing? See, what happens if I try to show you this way? Okay, so that's showing the Zoom window. If I go minimize,
hello,
show the desktop. So you should be seeing the desktop on the streamer now. So I don't have any browser open. And if I do
Alt-Tab,
that shows the Zoom meeting, the streamer, Zoom, Google Earth, SNAS, and there's what I got in Google Earth. I don't have the animation running yet because I have to do a couple things for that. If I do, see, here's all your locations. And if I come down here, it starts playing, but I need to make some adjustments to those. Right now they're delaying too long, and based upon how much it zooms in on each name, some of the names are hidden and stuff.
Morning.
So I'm going to stop that. Well, actually, before I stop that, I'm going to see how much of the CPU stream. The streamer is showing 71% CPU, 79%, 73. You might be seeing some glitching right now. 70%.
Hello, Doug.
So now if I switch back and stop the Google Earth animation, now what does my CPU say? 54%, 47%, 48%, 44%. So that makes a big difference. And I've still got my OneDrive paused. So what's going on? What are you hearing?
Hello, Doug. Darwin here.
Okay, here's what I'll do. Here's what I'll do. Give me a confirmation. I see, well, let me get back to the end of chat here. Harambe in the Zoom, Doug. Is Harambe on Zoom with me?
All right, this is Darwin.
Now, how about if I mute my Zoom? It shouldn't. Is he in your Zoom? If I go, there's a note in chat. Oh, chat. Darren is in chat.
You muted it.
Okay, let's see. I've got it. Am I showing that? I don't think so. Let's go see if I can show that. Does this come up for you? Yeah. So here I'm looking at my Zoom window. I see Darren Gilholm in chat to everyone. Hi, this is Darren. And he's laughing at me, according to Scotty. Tim's hearing the same thing. Did you forget to put on your... I shouldn't need my... Ooh! That might be it. That might be it.
Hey, there,
I don't need my headphones if I'm not talking to somebody on Zoom. But if somebody came into Zoom, you would be hearing them and I wouldn't. So, let's see. Okay, Darren, are you there? Say something.
Yes, I am.
Oh, there you are. That's it.
Hello?
Yes, I hear you. Now, let me see if I've got you set up. And to be coming through, are you gonna come in on camera or are you just gonna be voice?
I haven't got a camera. Just
camera?
Voice.
Oh, I'm part. Did you say just voice?
Just voice.
Oh, okay. Can you, since you can hear me now through Zoom, can you turn off the sound from your YouTube?
Right, that's off.
Yep, I can hear that. Okay, so now I don't have that echoing anymore. Okay, so tell me in chat, are you hearing Darren?
Nope.
Waiting to see somebody in chat, because there's a little bit of a delay. And you heard the delay.
You turned off your volume on.
Oh, yes. Okay, I just unmuted myself on Zoom. Okay, this is fun.
Just downloaded this Zoom, so
okay,
it's working.
Okay, very good. And let's see, are you watching me over the YouTube video or are you watching me on the Zoom video?
I'm now on Zoom.
Okay. And do I look a little blurry to you?
You look okay.
Okay. Because when I'm looking at myself in the Zoom video, it looks a little blurry. Now, I do have that going over. And you said you're not coming on camera. You're just going to be voice. Okay. Then I don't need to stay on the Zoom screen. I can go back over to here and put up my regular camera. So you guys just saw the difference between my Zoom camera and my streaming camera. I think the streaming camera looks a lot better. Now I can tell that I'm not going to keep up with chat. So if anybody's trying to make a chat message to me, be sure you do the at Live Windows Training so it shows up in orange for me. I'm taking a look back here, Darren, at what's, it's just Gary's the only one that has done that. I do not allow most email attachments. USB ports will not take flash drives and downloads for the most are monitored. So he has a whole bunch of computers under his purview. So He's preventing troubles and infections that way, apparently. So, Darren, did you have something on your mind you wanted to talk about, or are you just coming in to say hi? What's up?
Just coming in to say hi.
Oh, awesome. Glad you did. Glad to hear a voice.
This is from UK. It's hot, half 11.
Half past 11. Okay, in UK. Awesome. And I think, did you see your? I don't know if I've got you on the Google Earth yet,
You
do
should
I?
have. I put it down
Let's
last
go
night.
see.
UK
Oops.
Darren, get home.
You'd be over here, right? Okay, so let's put you in. And do I have that? I'm not showing that, am I? Let's push this button. See if that brings up. Yeah, that brought up the Google Earth. So yeah, you should be in here, in this area, right? Okay. So let's drop a pin there.
Oh yeah, I'm
And
looking in the other one now. Should be
pardon?
in middle.
In the
I'm looking
middle?
on
Okay.
YouTube at the moment. London.
Have I? Well, I'm going to move it when, at by your guidance once I get it. So, Darren Gilholm in, what do we want to say? UK, or do you want to be more
It's UK.
specific? Just UK.
Yeah.
Okay. And I did I spell that right? Two R's.
Yeah, that's right.
All right. So then, while I have this window open, I can now move this thumbtack anywhere around here. So you
Up,
tell me.
to your right.
To my right,
Straight up to the
straight up,
coastline. Up.
up more,
To your left.
left,
Close enough. That's
close enough.
it. That's it. That's
That's it right there.
close enough. That's.
All right, then I'm going to come over here and change the style to be a size of 3 and then click OK. And then that puts you in right here. Now I'm gonna move you in this list to be near Rick Hubbard, since you guys are close to each other on the globe, so that when I get the animation going, it'll go through these in order and kind of give a little. It's not gonna zoom in real close. All it's gonna do is like, when
Okay.
it's on Rick, it'll be there, and then it'll come over to show you. And that's what I've got in mind for that.
Yeah, that looks good.
Cool. Does
So
anybody else want me to add them on the globe while I'm here? Just put in your location in chat and I'll add you in if you're not seeing that. Oh, I see. MD Iqbal Hussein watching from Bangladesh. So this Google Earth is what I'm going to show during the pre-show when we're getting close to the time for the live stream to start. So if I just type in Bangladesh here, I'm just gonna take the globe around to Bangladesh, and then I'll have it zoomed out right around in here. So MD Iqbal Hussein, do you want to be on this and join the rest of the chat? Should I add a pin there for you? Yes or no? Blackwatch says, say something, I'm giving up on you. Are you referring to, let's see, that was 325. As V Manor says, you look much younger through the stream camera. I'll buy that. I'll buy that. Okay, so I haven't heard anything back from MD Iqbal about adding him, so let's move along. Now, move back to the streamer and then camera one. So what I'm about to do is create a new image for Windows 10 and reformat this computer with a fresh install of Windows 10. And then, this is my Windows 10 USB. And then I want to set it up with a bunch of games. That's what these people, the residents of these apartment buildings, use these computers for, is in the community center to play games and just pass the time of day. They can log into their own email through a web browser, assuming they know how to do that. But I want to have it somewhat locked down. So what I'm going to experiment with on this one is using a Microsoft account managed by your organization, you know, and give them a PIN to sign in. So they're not going to know the password. Okay, so Darren, you're welcome to hang out on Zoom if you want to interact, but I'm going to go ahead and turn my attention to making this
right
ISO image. Oh, and Darren, do you know how to do the space bar to mute, meaning mute yourself and then press the space bar to unmute when you want to say something?
Right, I'll do that now. Yeah,
you've got that now.
Yep.
Okay, so I'm going to switch over to. I don't actually get to see that since I don't have your camera. But anyway, that way your microphone is off until you actually want to speak, and so you right. don't accidentally get something coming out over the video. All right. Blackwatch wants to borrow a camera and a mic. And if this style of working, of broadcasting my actual work, is a thing I want to keep doing, I'm not sure if that microphone is a good choice. So I'm going to kind of, maybe after we go for a while and you find me moving around, turn away from that microphone, you might let me know. This microphone up here is they call it blue ice. I don't remember. Something blue. So for making this is computer number 3 right here. It's got a line going all the way around here to that monitor. That monitor is also plugged into a computer that's inside that closet. It's my print server. Yeah, I know, it's an illness. And then get that in there and then come over to computer number 3 and go grab the ISO. Just because it's my habit, media creation tool is the way I go to find it. Getting tangled in this wire. So also, I think a difference in this style of this video is going to be there might be an occasional dead air because I have to focus my intention sometimes on things without talking through them. We'll see how that goes. Download tool now. It's downloading to the bottom left corner of Google Chrome. There's that's done. And just click on it to launch it. I don't care about moving that to one of my utility folders because anytime I want that, it's just so easy to download it. And this is going to be downloading whatever the most current version of Windows 10 is on the Microsoft site. Oh, and I've told you about, I've mentioned during that Windows 11 video about the 4 videos that I have prepared and ready to publish. I have to make up, I have to make up thumbnails for them and title them and put descriptions on. And I was kind of deliberating whether I would just publish them all together at once so I can put the end cards that would give the links to the rest of the videos. And I kind of think that's the way I'm going to do it. And depending upon how I do with this work, I might actually do that during this live stream, meaning I was thinking I'd actually make the thumbnails during this live stream because that is computer work. So why not do that during a live stream? So that's getting a few things ready. Now this computer that I'm downloading this to is the slowest computer of all of these that are up here. Why did I choose that one? Well, only because it's on top of the desk right here and easy to get to. I might wind up regretting that. There we go. Accept the license terms. So now, interestingly, to my right, I've got the iMac, which has chat, and I have computer number two, which has the chat, and I see Gary just put in a message that's all red and orange to attract my attention. When regular users get the ability to download, they head over to Major Geeks and get their own utilities. Then they run the delete all company data command. LOL. Yeah. And then build the chat for the Windows 11 videos. Build the chat. Charge the chat for the Windows 11 videos. Yeah. You know, another piece of that with the Windows 11 videos, I thought I could actually play the Windows 11 videos that I made. I could play them during this live stream. And that way I kind of get your feedback on them live, but then still publish them as a separate videos. And part of the thinking behind that is while that's playing, I can turn off my sound and set a timer on my watch to let me know when it's done. And that way I can just put my attention on something else. So upgrade this PC. No, that's not what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna create installation media, click next. English Windows 10 architecture, use recommended options for this PC. No, I don't wanna use recommended options for this PC because I might be doing that for Windows Home or Pro. No, that's not what that matters. All the computers that I would use would be 64-bit. I can't imagine installing Windows 10 on a 32-bit computer. I did install Windows 7 on some 32-bit computers for that cabling company that I've told you about. They were, the software they were using could not run on a 64-bit Windows 7. Had to be 32-bit Windows 7. So I could use the recommended options for this PC. It's not going to be any different. But whether I put that check marker there now or not is irrelevant. So clicking next. Needs to be at least 8. If you want to install 10 on another ISO burn. Okay, so it's going to be to the USB flash drive. But before I tell it to do that, I just did Windows key E, so I can go look at that flash drive and be sure it is what I think it is and figure out what drive letter it's on. It's this drive letter D. Yeah, so that's the way the USB drive would look when it has a Windows 10 ISO on it. So that's what we're gonna use as the D drive, USB flash drive, click next. Removable devices D, it automatically gave me only that to choose from. Getting things ready. and Z says to Gary, it's free from Microsoft, no need to charge us. Well, my Windows 11 videos aren't free from Microsoft. I think that's what Gary was referring to. But my videos are free anyway. So I'm seeing 14 concurrent viewers and 8 likes. Thank you everybody for being here with me and keeping me company. So now, while that's doing its thing, this computer, I turned it on. I have not even logged into it to see what its current state is. I don't really care. So I don't have this connected to my remote software at the moment. It is configured for that. But again, like down here, I've got usernames that are revealing. And I wanna sign in with this one. See if I remembered that password right. I suppose if you're really, really good at figuring out what fingers I just used, you could figure out how to log into this computer with that name before the reformat. It's not going to be the same once I reinstall. So let's see, I've got you on that camera. You're seeing that, you're seeing me. Yeah, so all these icons here, those are all games that the residents in this apartment building installed on the computer. And I think this go around with these computers, I think what I did is, I think I gave their username admin at local administrator right, so they could install games without bothering anybody, without having anyone to come over. And what I did is I had image backups so that if they messed it up, I would just go in and restore the image backup. And I've tried several different things. Back with Windows 7, I found some, you know, nanny type programs that locks down a computer for kids. So we had that on there for a while. It was a total pain in the yes. Because we always had to go, or somebody had to go help them with something. So let's see. Let me see if they have rights. Sign in options. No, that's not the way I want to go. I want to go users. Add remove users. Preview, add users isn't available. Sign in options. I don't think this is going to show what I want. So when I picked up these computers yesterday from the two different locations at the apartment building that I refer to as Mike, they have three of these. And two of them were on at the time. One of them was off with a sign on it saying, "This computer is broken. Sorry for the inconvenience." The apartment building golf had one computer up and running on, and the other one had a sign on it, "This computer is broken. Do not touch it." A little more stern there. Let's see, your info. Does this show? Oh, and then here's another issue. And you can't see it, and that's intentional. It's all whited out, but I figured you can't see it because it's too far away. But it has the local account name, and then under that, it has an email address, an outlook.com email address, which means a resident actually converted this computer to be logging in with their Microsoft 365 account. Yet when I just signed into it, I used the local account password and that worked. I'm thinking, oh, I know why. Because if you install Windows 10 with a Microsoft account, then that Microsoft account password is going to be the password for logging in. That's not what happened here. This is logging in with a local user account. And then they got one of those prompts that Microsoft puts at various places. Do you want to sign in regularly or get full features or something like that? And you say yes to that. And that makes the computer then sign in with a Microsoft account. But I've never seen that combination that it actually has an email address here. Interesting. Manage my Microsoft account. So then when I go to email accounts, it shows that person's account and it shows a Gmail account. And sign in options, work or school account. Now, the option for adding a user is not here, which tells me that this is a standard user account. Since I can't add someone else to the computer. Yeah. That's why that add users wasn't coming up, I guess. Well, this computer feels pretty responsive. Let me try launching one of these games. And I do not have it connected to the internet. No. Yeah, play error. Okay, so that generated an error because it's not connected to the internet. Once that computer is connected to the internet, it might show up that it's got troubles. Clicking up through chat, the only place I see my name in orange is from the last one I read from Gary, so I'm not going to read through the rest of them. Again, if you want to get my attention in chat, do that at Live Windows Training so it shows up in orange. On my computer, what is the specs of the computers you're working on? Okay, let's go figure that one out. Oh, by the way, all five of the computers are the exact same model. These are all-in-one HPs, so the computer's built into the monitor. Let's go, is it gonna let me do MS Info as a regular user account? I think so. MS Info 32. It's telling me X64 Celeron CPU J3060 at 1.60 gigahertz, two cores, BIOS version AMI F.15 dated August 23rd, 2016. Now, keep in mind before you get judgmental about this computer, it is not a work computer. It is for residents to play games on. And if it gets mucked up, we'll just be doing image restores down the road. So I'm not too worried about having them all up to speed with updates. Elevation, what else do we want to know about this? Physical memory, 4 gigabytes. So clearly not high powered computers, which is okay. My client is required to provide computers for their residents. The level of the computers is not specified. Let's see, Chris, okay, chit-chat from Gary. Can they do Gmail or email or print? They cannot print. They're not allowed to print. They don't have a path for printing. There's no printers available. If the office staff wanted to help them get something printed, I've never had them ask me that, so I don't think they ever have. I think the residents would be required to turn to their family for that or turn to some other support organization that they are involved with. These are in a community center, which is basically, think of it as a huge break room, entertainment. They have table games. They do, what's that thing where have that cage with the balls in it? Bingo. Rocket ships, yep, that's right. Blackwatch. Does it have a GPU? Only that's the graphics capability would be built into the processor. There's no separate graphics card for sure. These are all-in-one computers. So there's a power cable, there's a mouse and a keyboard. There's nothing else connected. There's a CD drive here. It's disabled. Disabled it just by, oh, in CMOS, I think is where I disabled those. And I couldn't disable USB because we need keyboard and mouse. If, let's see, can it, does it tell me anything else about graphics? Multimedia display. I'm in system information components display. Intel HD graphics. Intel Corporation compatible. Adapter RAM 1 GB. So that's implying it is some kind of a graphics adapter distinct from the CPU, isn't it? Let's see. I don't have anything identifiable displayed here, so let's give you a better view of that if I can. Now I've got to get, I have auto focus and auto exposure disabled for all these cameras so you don't keep wigging out. I'll go change that. Turn on automatic adjustments for this camera. So then you can read that. So that shows that for graphics. Let's go look at Device Manager. You are logged in as a standard user. You can view device settings in Device Manager, but you must be logged on as an administrator to make changes. So here, display adapters, Intel HD graphics. Okay, is there anything else in there you want to see? Guess I just made you seasick, didn't I? 72% on creating that USB memory stick. Are residents just folks or something else? So these three apartment buildings that I've been reporting on through, where are you? That I've been reporting on through Tech Tales, they are government subsidized housing for elderly and disabled. So yeah, that pretty much covers it. I've overheard them talking to people and you have to be at least 55 years old and I think on some kind of government assistance or disabled. You can be in there younger than 55 if you have a certain level of disability and you have to have your total assets have to be under a certain barrier, your total income has to be under a certain barrier or a certain level. So they are okay in a, oh, what, parts of town that are lower economic regions, you would say. And let's see, looking through, I'm not going to try reading everything. So if you want my attention on something that you've typed into chat, then do that at sign live windows training. So Chris Garrett, you're the one that has the radio interference issue, correct? Am I remembering your name correctly? Could you just give me a confirmation in chat that that's yours? Because I was also thinking we can handle that during this session if you're if you show up. Sorry, I'm a few minutes behind. By the way, I will try not to respond in chat. I will try not to respond in chat. I had to pause to eat. So on business models, you can disable each USB one by one. Okay, maybe this isn't going to be convenient for you, Chris, to work on your issue. If it is, then speak up. I'm going to go back and look at my email on computer two. Yes, Chris Garrett. Zvi Manor asks, what is the disk volume on those computers? You can create an image for the computer or use kiosk app. Kiosk app might be something I should become familiar with. I would welcome maybe paste a link into chat for that. I have not gone searching for that. What is the disk volume on those computers? Are you asking for the size of the disk? I'm guessing. Let's not do it that way. Oh, I guess you can kind of see that computer in my thumbnail, can't you? So I'm going to look at the C drive, right click on the C drive, properties. We've got 83.7 gigabytes in use out of a 224 gigabyte disk. Clonezilla.org, size yes. So I gave you that. Clonezilla. All right, let's go look at clonezilla.org. This is in response to kiosk, I suppose. Let's see when. Zvi Manor, you can create an image for the computer or use kiosk app. So is kiosk app what this clonezilla.org is, or is kiosk app something from Microsoft or in the Microsoft Store? Give me some feedback on that. If you would, Clonezilla, partition disk manage, cloning, similar to true image system. Well, now wait a minute, Clonezilla, this sounds like jumping ship from what I'm already familiar with Macrium Reflect. I don't need to jump to another product that does disk imaging. Macrium Reflect, I have a license for, and I know it really well. Is there some reason that does Clonezilla actually accomplish the kiosk app? Clonezilla is a Linux tool to clone drives. Yeah, that doesn't appeal to me at all. Well, they're indicating Windows, but still, it looks like a cloning software. So that doesn't look like it's the kiosk. Kiosk, I expect, if my understanding what you're implying there is that turn the computer on, it's really locked down to whatever the administration has installed on it. Gary, we'll use what you know. Thank you. Yes, William, that computer would be helped by a SSD, even 250 gigabyte. We're not interested in rocket ship. We're not interested in disk jobs. This is for entertainment purposes, for residents, cheap as possible to meet the requirements that's placed on my client. So no, we're not going to be doing that. Clonezilla is for image. Deep Freeze is a kiosk app, but it's not free. Yeah, I don't. I'm reluctant to spend the time to try something new and spend the money on it for five computers when I can't tell my client that I'm sold on this. So what I have in mind, and we can discuss it, I'm open to this being challenged, and I haven't been down this road before, so I'm serious when I say that I'm open to your input. But what I have in mind is creating a Microsoft account for residents at, and then their domain name for both of these buildings. Actually install Windows utilizing that Microsoft account. Then create a, or I actually might install Windows using the admin level account, and then create an account on the computer tied to a Microsoft account, sign it in with its password, then give it a PIN. And that's what the residents will use to turn the computer in and sign on, is they'll just type in the PIN. They'll never know the password. It'll be a standard user account. It'll be an account that's managed by your organization. It'll have whatever restrictions I can put on it. I'm going to do that choice that says only Microsoft Store apps. And I think even if they try to do that, somebody will have to come in and type an administrator code for them, and whatever other ways that I can lock it with Microsoft Edge and Google Chrome, some options there to put the highest level of security and cautions on it. Those are the directions that I'm thinking. So once I do that setup on this computer, then create an image, restore it to the other computers. And the only thing that I'll need to change is for the other building. Because remember, these are five computers from two different buildings. That's two different domain names. So I'll want the alternate domain names on the other two computers. So I'm creating this for the building that has the three computers. Get your numbers right, Doug. Three fingers, not two, if you're trying to say the number three. And then restore that to one of the computers for the other one that only has two. I'm searching for a free app, Z Manor. And requirements of government. Yeah, because this is government subsidized facility. That's what their requirements would come from. So then over here, we've got flash drive is ready. Clicking finish. Volume license not in. No. For three computers, we're not going to be entitled for a volume license. Why do you want admin rights on the PC? Well, I want to be able to do administration functions on the computer when I connect remotely to it. If they call needing some kind of support. So I already do that commonly, where I can connect to a computer that the user is on a standard account. I can connect with an admin account and interact with their restricted account and do whatever management work I need to do. Chris Garrett says, yes, I am the one. I had video pause, but I jump ahead. Okay, so yeah, Chris, I'm thinking I'd like to work on or discuss your issue here in a little bit. Chris, are you able to stay with us for a while, or are you limited on time? Let's see. So that I downloaded that tool. I've got it on the USB, so ready to eject the USB. And for those who want to tell me that ejecting it isn't necessary, I'm aware of that. I still do that, particularly since this computer was just writing to that USB. And so that icon disappeared. It never actually gave me a message saying it's safe to remove, but that seems to happen with some computers that they just don't notify you. I think that's a check mark. Once you select that on a particular computer, then that's the end of the story. So, take that out. I'm about to shut this computer down and then boot it on the memory stick. So if somebody is having another question before I do that, you better get your question out soon. And Chris says he can stay. Thank you. I thought you meant one admin account. From Gary. I'm guessing we're on the same page now. So each computer would have an admin account so that I can connect and work on it. I'm not certain whether I need to install Windows utilizing the admin account, then create the restricted account, or if I install Windows with the restricted account and then add an admin account. Seems to me like I should install it with the admin account. And Gary says two accounts. There's two businesses involved, two domain names, two offices. So they each have their own Microsoft 365 setup. So the two buildings will have to have different admin names, but I want to use the same admin user account on each of the computers. They're signing in to the same Microsoft account for the apartment building Mike. All three computers are registered or administered under one administrator email account on Microsoft 365, and the three computers all will log in with the same restricted user account. So like if they did all three computers, if they went into office.com to look at email, they'd all be seeing the same email account. We are not required to provide email accounts for them. They could go to a website and log into their own email account. If all the same, do one and clone the drives. Yeah, that's what I'm going to do, except for the minor change of the domain name. Look into a program from Pharonix.com called Deep Freeze. You're going to have to give me more of a reason to look into it than just that. Is that for a kiosk operation? If that's for, can you give me a little more explanation of why you're saying I should look into that? Chris saying I'm funny. Thank you, I think. So shutting down this computer now. And let's see, I don't know what the boot key is or CMOS key is, so I'm just going to try at random. This has the taskbar up at the top, which we're not going to be able to do with Windows 11. Well, that's fun. Remember when I was mentioning the USB ports? I have to have keyboard and mouse, so I can't disable USB ports. There's only two USB ports. They're both occupied. So I'm going to disconnect the mouse, because I think I can get through the full installation of Windows 10 without a mouse. And if that fails, then I'll plug in a keyboard mouse that uses the one transceiver. Power button's under the bottom corner here. Liberace on the keyboard. Press escape key for startup menu. There's a startup menu. Let's take a look at BIOS setup. Enter pass setup password for BIOS. Of course I did that. So let's go figure out what that password is. Let's see, I'm not gonna bring that screen up in normal view, but OneNote is where I keep all of my notes. So all of these tabs have different information for this client. And each one of these tabs can have a whole bunch of pages. So this is all the pages that are on this particular tab. And right now I'm on a page called Resident New Computers. And is that the right? Yeah, that's the right building. Let's try Control F, BIOS. No matches. Setup. Two matches. It's not that one. There it is. CMOS setup password. Yeah, I would not have guessed that in a million years. There we go. AMI BIOS 2016 version 2.17.1249. I'm not going to do a BIOS update. Get over it. Device configuration, hard disk. SATA 500.1 gigabytes. Oh, I read off to you how large the hard drive was. And I just realized now there was a, I think this is partitioned. I think there's a partition that I have images stored so that I could restore an image from a partition. And I could also program the computer to do an image backup anytime that I chose without having to connect another drive to it. So it's a 500 gigabyte drive. Western Digital, clearly a spinning drive. SATA emulation is set on AHCI as opposed to show me the alternative, but AHCI is the right thing for it to be on. Boot order. USB comes before the hard drive already, so just because I have USB plugged in, it's going to boot to that. Anybody want to speculate as to whether this computer has TPM 2.0? Yeah, you better be laughing at that. Silly question. Okay, so restarting through BIOS. I'm not going to bother with a boot option key because I have the USB plugged in and it's already configured to boot prior to the hard drive. So when I get to the setup screen for Windows 10, we should be able to see the second partition. And I'm just going to delete the first partition and install on that first partition. Don't need to save anything that's on the computer. Let's see, I guess I'll switch back here and see what's going on in chat. Scroll up to what I have highlighted, and I'm just looking for the things that have specified my name, so it shows up in orange. What God is very good, reflect. What you've got is very good, Macrium reflect. Yeah. The chat froze. The BIOS looked okay. I'm taking a look at stream health. Stream is healthy since 3:02 p.m. So I don't see anything there. That BIOS looks like my HP Elite 8300. You may be able to disable USB one by one. I'm not going to pursue that because it hasn't been a problem. They have administration eyes. They have staff in the area. They have security there. They have people that think on each other. So, and unless you people putting in USB drives becomes a problem, I'm not going to fix a problem that doesn't exist. So you have image backup, then why reinstall Windows? Good question. I've got an even better answer. And look what happened. Oh, you know what? I messed up there, didn't I? So it booted up to Windows, and I think it's because when it tries to boot from the USB, I think it says, it probably says press any key to boot from USB. The other possibility is that USB is formatted with FAT rather than GPT, and the BIOS on this computer might not be able to boot from a, what's the right way to say it, GPT memory stick. So it might not have recognized the memory stick. And the mouse is not functional, right? So I'm going to use the tab key to get over here to the power icon. And then enter key. And then I can use arrow keys to go to restart. And I'm going to have to watch it. Restart anyway. It says, if you restart now, you and other people using this PC could lose unsaved work. Silly that they would say that. It hasn't been logged in as anybody since starting. So I'm choosing restart anyway. I'm going to watch the screen, see if there's a prompt or if it recognizes that memory stick at all. So I could redo the memory stick from this computer. That memory stick is not partitioned, so I don't mind completely wiping out the memory stick. And I still have Z Manners question highlighted over there, so I'm going to get back to that. Got to watch this. Spinning circle of dots. Yeah, I didn't get any prompt. So I'll go into File Explorer and have a look at the partition style for this hard drive and have a look at the partition style for that memory stick. I think I'm saying that right. No, I don't have USB disabled. I was just wondering if I have something disabled to prevent it from booting from USB. And mouse is not functional because I have the USB memory stick plugged in. I want to keep it that way, so this is going to be fun. I'm going to try to do all these manipulations with keyboard only. Here's the USB drive down here. I want to get to computer management, or actually, let's see. I'm trying to think of the run command for going straight into computer management. compmgmt.msc, I think. So Windows key R, device, no, compmgmt.msc, enter. Ah, that worked. All right, down arrow to get to disk management. Yeah, I got stuck on one of them. I was trying to bring up the detail. Okay, so I don't want to restore the image backup because they've been allowed to install games from anywhere. And we think that what they've installed is mucked up the system. So if I just restore from an image, even if it's prior to the troublesome programs, then we're just going to continue working on the same philosophy of them being logged in with a local user account. It's a standard account, but they're still able to install software. So what I've got in mind is I want to use, and I don't know how successful this is going to be, but the strategy at this point is to use the Microsoft accounts, use the capabilities built in with Microsoft to restrict things, and in particular, do the option that says install only Microsoft Store apps, only allow Microsoft Store apps, something along those lines. So basically, taking a different strategy. Also, the image backups are like 2 years old. Well, we'll take a look in a moment how old they are, because they're kind of old, which means I would restore those and then have to go through all the updates for five computers. Yeah, I suppose I could do the updates on one computer and then clone that to the others. But our strategy is for me to select a suite of games, install those on the computer, then do what I can to lock it down and create images at that level, and then they can be restored later. Does it have Windows? I'm guessing you're referring to the USB memory stick. Does it have Windows? I just created the installation ISO on it. Press any key, but I cannot find the any key. Yeah, that was a joke my mom, first time I heard that joke about the any key was from my mother 20 years ago. Z-Manner, is the port you put the dock in USB 3? I highly doubt this computer even has a USB 3 port. He could use a USB hub to help out. Yeah, I could. Fair that. And I have them. Chris, what happens when you tap F9 at HP logo? See if there's an option to boot to USB. Mine shows that option. I have to use legacy, but yours could give under UEFI. Yeah, I was thinking that because boot from USB was shown before the hard drive, that I shouldn't have to do that. Keyboard Guru, I like that nickname. Keyboard Guru. Sweet. May be wrong, you may have to create USB on that device when UEFI and secure boot. This, I'm sure this isn't secure boot. It's too old for that, I think. All right. Logged in as a standard user. That's the device manager populated. So I'm gonna use down arrow key to get lower. Disk manager, you do not have rights to local disk manager. Okay, so. Let's get out of there and go to the start button. Remember, taskbar is on the top of this computer. Come down to the profile icon. Now, when I press the down arrow key, it's going through these tiles. So I need shift tab to get over to the left column. Then I can use down arrow key to get down to the profile icon, press enter, and then use down arrow twice to get to sign out. Then I'm going to have to go look up the admin password, which is not the same as the CMOS setup password, I don't think. Is it? No, it's not. So then enter, and now I've got to move the cursor from here over to here. So that's shift tab until I see a dotted line around one of the usernames. So there I've got a line around staff. Up arrow, no, shift tab, yeah, shift tab to get to the next username up the list. Enter, and then that puts the blinking cursor in the password field. And it is, okay. I dare you to figure out what password I just typed. That's not the same password that I'm going to set these computers up. So seriously, if you want to try to guess that, put it in chat. That password is not used for anything else in their office. Okay, still no mouse. Windows key R and comp mgmt.msc. Enter. Z Manor says F4 in Windows. Whoops, retracted. Okay, down arrow rapidly to get all the way down to disk management so it doesn't try to pull up device manager and stall me at that point. So here I'm seeing C drive, NTFS, the USB, FAT32. I'm a little weak on what I need to be looking for here. I want to get down into this section and check how the volume is set up. And I'm trying to find a keyboard method to get down there. Okay. Can down arrow through this. Can I get details when I'm up here without going down here? How would I do that? I want to look at C drive, enter on the C drive. No. Tab. Oh, that took me down here. Okay, tab key took me down here. And then go over here to the C drive. And then I'm thinking shift enter. No. Shift space bar, space bar. How am I going to get details of that? Alt V for view. Settings. No, that's settings for computer management. I want a way to open up this, access the information panel for this C drive. I'm about to turn over to chat and see if somebody's telling me how to do that. I'm not getting it. Z Manor says from desktop Alt F4 to get power options. Alt plus F4 to put the pop out chat back to normal. Power options. Why would I want power options? Alt F4. That just closed that window. That's not helping me anywhere. No. That was not what I want. I'm not sure what you're trying to get me to there. Okay, now, can I get here quicker? Down arrow rapidly to get all the way to disk management so it doesn't try to pull something else up. And then tab to get over into this panel. And now I'm down to here. And then over to the C drive. So the way that I'm going to use to figure that out is I'll come over here to computer number 2 and go compmgmt.msc. It's another key, not Alt plus F4 from Chris. Okay, I'm going to go to computer management and right click on the C drive. What I'm trying to get to is properties for the C drive. So it's probably a keyboard shortcut for opening a properties window. Wait a minute, that's not what I wanted. No, it's over here, isn't it? Right click over here in properties and volumes and here. So this one's an MBR. That's what I was trying to get, is to see that it's MBR rather than GPT. Well, how about using the command prompt disk tool for that? I don't think this shows me MBR versus GPT in here. So Alt space bar, Alt escape, no. Enter, Control Enter, Shift Enter, Alt Enter. Right click, no keyboard shortcut visible from that. Settings already looked at. Rescan all tasks, file. Futile. This is futile. The right partition not have letter sign. The right partition not have a letter sign. Morning crew, what we trying to do? Hello, Lance. I'll summarize that in a minute here. It's over in where it shows disk 0. Right click there. Yeah, I did. Okay, so you guys were giving me that before I found it. And it's in here for MBR versus GPT. So this, okay, here, let's go this way. Unplug the keyboard, plug in the mouse. I've still got the memory stick connected. So just do it with a mouse operation. So here's properties for the hard drive, volumes. It's a GPT. How about that? It's not MBR. I kind of thought it was going to be an MBR. And this memory stick is what? MBR. Okay, so that's the problem. Oh, remember I told you that my computer number 3 is old and slow. So it must be an MBR partition. Okay. I'm already logged in with admin here, but I don't have internet connected to that. All right. So here's what I'll do. Now I'm totally mouse driven, no keyboard connected. I've got the USB in place. I've got an Ethernet cable on my computer number 3, which is that one. So I'm about to pull the Ethernet cable from there, which means that computer is not going to be useful for a while. Use the Ethernet on here, create a fresh ISO Windows 10 using this computer, and then with that, install Windows, do a fresh Windows 10 install, and while the ISO is downloading from here, I will explain for those who came in after my previous explanation, what I am up to. All right, Microsoft Edge. Not for any particular reason, just because I did it. And then media creation tool. Now, updates. Here's what's new. Oh, keyboard's not functional. Ay, caramba. Okay, I don't need the USB memory stick for a while. So I'm gonna use keyboard and mouse. So you're not getting a good view of this computer because it is a client's computer, and I don't want to inadvertently expose something. It is a billable client's computer. Opening the creation tool. And I have five of these in my possession right now from two different client buildings, and they are both apartment buildings where their tenants are all government subsidized. Well, it's government subsidized housing for their tenants, and not just government subsidized due to financial need, but they have to be of a certain age or they have to be disabled. And they have to be below a certain assets and below a certain income. And I think also there's some kind of a lack of, I'm not sure. I was going to say lack of resources available from family. I'm not sure about that piece. And they are required to provide computers for the residents in what's called their community center. It's a place where they have table games, board games. These are there for, mostly they use them for games. They could use them for signing on to their email through the internet. But because my clients are required to provide these, they don't have to be an impressive computer. They just are required to have access to the internet. I don't think it's specifically that they're required to provide games on computers, but I think they're required to provide internet access, but it can be very restricted. So these computers, they have been idle during COVID, and now they're reopening their community center, and they asked me to refresh these computers and get them up to snuff. Well, in the apartment building that I refer to as Mike, in my Tech Tales series of videos, they have three computers. One of them had a sign on it saying it's broken. I haven't checked that one out yet. The other building that I refer to as the apartment building Golf, it has two computers. One of them had a sign, broken, don't use. So I have all five of these computers now, and my intention is to set them up a little differently to try a different approach to lessen the amount of junk that gets installed on the computers because they get so slow and not working very well. So that was my method of answering the question of what we're doing. For Lance, Win10 setup does GPT. It'll do GPT or MBR depending upon the computer that you're doing it from. So when I created the USB memory stick, the ISO image that's on that memory stick is, you know, you might be challenging me on this, but I was going to say that it's only going to work on an MBR computer. Windows 10 setup does GPT. I think he's telling me that this memory stick should be able to install Windows 10 if BIOS is set for it. Okay, so this is I downloaded that and it's getting a few things ready. Okay, so if Blackwatch is steering me the right direction, if I go ahead and finish this through, make this memory stick on a UEFI computer, then I should still find that it behaves the same way and the computer doesn't boot automatically to that memory stick. What I'm saying with a level of confidence that's like this, okay, not this, but this, is that when I created that memory stick on this older computer that's an NVR computer, not UEFI, that memory stick is not going to boot this computer that's configured for UEFI. And Ada is pointing out that keyboard is unplugged, cut that. And if secure boot enabled, it will do GPT, I think. So I should check about secure boot. I highly doubt that secure boot is enabled. Only 500 gigabyte drive, so what is GPT needed for? Well, I guess it's not that GPT is needed. Isn't that just the default for a UEFI computer? Doug was working in the yard. Hope all is good. Updated BIOS can't run 3333. Have to run at 3200. From Greg Guy. Was working in the yard. Hope is all good. Updated BIOS can't run as 333. So I'm thinking that you're referring to your CPU speed. After you updated your BIOS, you can't run at 33.33 gigahertz. You have to run at 32 gigahertz or 3.2 gigahertz, wherever the decimal belongs. Does need a BIOS date all five. I'd rather not do that. Only if I'm forced to. Only five in chat? Oh, 18 concurrent viewers. So if you click on the three, all right, this is ready. I'll turn back to that in a moment. Create installation media. So yep, I'm gonna go ahead and do that now. Recommended options for this PC. Flash drive. Refresh. Oh, cannot find a USB flat. Look, computers are supposed to be smart. It should have known that I meant to have this plugged in. I really did mean it. So, do I give up mouse or do I give up keyboard? I think I'm going to give up keyboard this time. Ooh, well, the flash drive is capable of 3.0. The USB port is not colored, but it does have the SS indicator. Keyboard's not working. I was going to go look to see if there's USB 3.0 in Device Manager. So the colored tabs on a USB port, the SS indicator, the lightning bolt indicator, the lightning would be indicating it's has more power capability. All right, so let's see, it is universal serial bus. That is 3.0. Yeah, so those ports are 3.0. It's a 3.0 flash drive, so I'm gonna go back. USB flash drive, click next. Yes, it found that. So all of that was no explanation as to why it didn't boot off of that USB. You're correct. If it was made on older legacy computer, it will not work for UEFI. Yeah, I think that is what's going on. So I want to say in terms of five in chat. So if you come up to the kebab menu and look at participants, this is only going to show you people who have recently said something in chat. There could still be people watching the live stream who have chatted earlier, but after some amount of time, they're no longer on this list. I haven't figured out how that is judged, but here's a test. We're at 4:45 right now. It's 4:45 here. That's my actual time. If I scroll all the way up, no, it's going back to the beginning. So it is showing everything there, but I'm sure there are people watching that have already participated in chat that are not currently showing up on this participants list. Now, I'm saying that because I have been on a live stream myself and participated in chat. And then if I don't chat for a while, I come in here and look at participants and I'm no longer on the list, even though I'm still watching. So some of you that are watching right now, if you go in to look at this list, you might find that you're not on this list if your name hasn't shown up on the screen for a while. Scrolling back up to see, okay, legacy computer. Did I miss some other things? No, I saw those. And then Gary says, I would not use smart drive, LOL. Was that part of this subject, smart drive? I'm lost what that is in reference to. If it shows us 3.0, if the RAM works, the difference between the two is not enough to worry about. If the RAM works, the difference between the two, I guess those are RAM memory speeds, I guess. Gary lurking, jump into chat, water's fine. He's just encouraging for those of you who are watching and haven't spoken up in chat. You are certainly welcome to say hello and participate. I know that I tried to encourage more to come in. Yes, I'm here, not on the list. So Ada is telling us, and I'm sorry, Ada, I'm thinking that is a female name, but I'm not certain. I don't want to offend you by being wrong. Yes, I'm here, not on the list. So she saw that she's not on the list. Go to the hamburger menu and see now that there's Ada. And if Ada looks there, she'll see that Ada is on the list now. Gary, smart drive DOS. Yeah, smart drive DOS 6.22. Boy, that's a blast from the past. Yeah. Hello, Ryan. Ada, I'm a ghost. And Chris says you are now. Okay, so progress 10%. Let's talk about Chris. Chris had engaged me in something that was asking for help with his. He's got a AT&T UVerse internet only, no TV. He's got a portable AM/FM radio. He likes to listen to the FM radio. With this AT&T router connected, he gets a lot more interference. The stations don't come in nearly as clear. He made a video of it. It's posted on his channel. I could play it here, but I think it's easy enough to describe it. Or we could put a link in the chat if you want to go play it. Now the significant things there, he scrolls through radio channels in demonstrating this, and I would have preferred, Chris, if you would have stayed on the one channel that you were getting. But the channel that was really the test basis that I could tell, when he's on that channel and the AT&T router is connected, you can't hear the station at all. When he unplugs the power from the AT&T modem, then you can hear the radio station. It still has a lot of static. It would be very unpleasant listening to music. I could imagine somebody listening to talk radio. And I'm deducing maybe he likes having the radio while he's doing other things on the computer. You know, of course, most people just play music through their computer. So one of his questions to me is, do other people experience this? And I have to say, I have no idea, because I don't have anybody that's trying to use a small, you know, basically low value AM/FM radio while they're working on their computer. My complaint with my clients is they got too much music and stuff playing through their computer. You know what? I want to take these earpieces out. We haven't heard from... are you still there, Darren? Darren was on the Zoom session. Looks like he is there. Darren, I'm going to go ahead and take these out. If you wind up wanting to talk, then I'll put them back in. But they've been in long enough. So yeah, I've got more to explain as I see questions start coming in. So you might give me a minute to explain more of the scenario. Yeah, so I don't have clients actually doing that. So I don't know. I was thinking I could bring I have a small AM/FM radio. I could bring it in near my Comcast router and see what happens with that. But I have some other ideas to point out. And maybe, Chris, you've already tried some of these. And one of the things Chris was asking is there some kind of filter to put on that can be put on the UVerse device? And I think not. As I understood from the video that Chris sent me, he has already tried disabling Wi-Fi on the AT&T device, on the AT&T modem. So as I understand that, Chris, and you need to confirm this for me, that you went into the administration panel of the UVerse and turned off the Wi-Fi radios, both of them, the 2.4 gigahertz and the 5.0 gigahertz. And that you still have the same symptom, where when you unplug the modem, the router modem, then the FM clears up. So then the next level of things that occur to my mind, you asked, could the Ethernet be causing an issue? Well, okay, so unplug all the Ethernet and see if that clears it up. I don't think it would, because the Ethernet power level is really very, very low. So it's hard to imagine that could be causing any interference. I have some suspicions. So another thing to try is your AT&T signal cable that comes into the modem. Disconnect it. Of course, you have no internet at that point, but the AT&T router is still plugged into power. So if you disconnect the signal cable, the AT&T signal cable, the router is still connected to power. Do you still have the interference? Now, you don't need to respond to each of these. And he's confirming he went in and disabled both 2.4 and 5.0. And I was sure of that. Did Darren get dunked? I think he's still there. And Darren, if you press your space bar and talk, the worst that's going to happen is a little bit of echo. And that's fine if you want to pipe in with something verbally. So, other ideas for Chris, is a long extension cord plugged into the same electrical outlet that the AT&T router is currently plugged in to, so that you can get the AT&T router way off into another room. So now when you unplug it, does the FM signal clear up in the same way? If it does, then that implies that it has to do with your electrical connection, not the router itself, because the router's way over there. If it's putting out any interference, it at least should be reduced by being way out there. Then another question is, when you have the router at its current location, if you take that AM/FM radio, take it into the other room, do you get the clearer version of the signal, or do you still get the same interference? Again, that's kind of confirming that you've got, whether you have a signal radiation from the AT&T router, or is it an electrical? See, you're in a mobile home, as I understand. So my suspicion there is, could there be something about the electrical wiring or the electrical connectors that's putting out some static that your FM picks that up? It seems to me that you mentioned somewhere about having changed internet providers. So is this a recent symptom? Did that FM radio used to work fine and then something changed? Did you get a new router? Did you switch services? Anything change in that area electrically? You've got a lot of equipment there with computers and whatever else. Okay, so I'm seeing a response there from Chris. I will try that. I do need new cable, but it has to be special one. It's green data cable. In order to replace that cable, yes. But I don't think we've, so that would be your signal cable, your AT&T signal cable coming from the AT&T equipment to the AT&T router connection. If that cable is faulty, it might be putting out the interference signal. And so you're going to try disconnecting that. And see, if you disconnect that and still have the same interference, then that tells me the problem is in the power side of it, not the signal side of it. Z Manners saying he found a free kiosk app, and I don't, and that's implying to me that you don't have experience with it. I'm reluctant to go try the kiosk app route without somebody's that has used it. I like the approach that I'm taking. I'm more familiar with it. I don't think I want to jump ship and go try something else when I haven't even tried the solution that's native to Microsoft. Then Chris says, yes, I can take the radio to another room and the reception is better. Okay, so it takes it to another room, reception is better. So the interference is only when you're there near the router, but that has not distinguished whether it's the router's signal source or the router's electrical connection. Because when you remove power from the router, the signal is cut off. The signal is no longer active, right? When you have the power connected, then you could be getting interference from either power or from signal. Then when you take the radio into the other room, is it operating on battery power or is it plugged into electrical? If it's plugged into electrical, is it plugged into a different circuit breaker circuit than when you're in the same room as the router? So what I'm getting at there is if you're taking the radio to another room, plugging it into electrical outlet, it might be on a different circuit breaker, which might be an issue. If you're able to plug it into an electrical outlet that's a long distance away or the farthest away possible from the router, but it's on the same circuit breaker and you still have the interference, then that would say your radio is getting the interference through the electrical. Now that radio looks like it probably has battery capability. So maybe this whole time you've been running on batteries. Have you tried brand new batteries, see if it improves? Does your battery compartment have any corrosion on the battery connectors, because I think that could conduct electrical signals from the room. Not my area of expertise, but just an idea. Let's see, Gary, does the radio work in the kitchen now? I guess that's, I can take the radio to another room, reception is better. Okay, but when I need the answer is, are you plugging into a different electrical circuit? If it's on battery in both locations, then the electrical circuit is not part of the factor. Chris, yes, from the phone jack, it's a green data cable. Okay, yeah, the green cable plugs into phone jack, goes to the AT&T router, looks like it's an RJ11 connector, I think. RJ12 connector, you said, okay. I'm not sure if I can, I don't think I can say what the difference is between. Oh, I think maybe RJ11 is just two conductors and RJ12 is four conductors on that smaller size jack. Phone jack to computer. Phone jack to computer. Not sure what you're saying there. You can't plug the AT&T phone signal direct into the computer. It's not compatible with the computer. And we haven't heard from you about disconnecting all the Ethernet, although I don't have much hope for that. Let's see, that's why I rent from all... Okay, Blackwatch gave me another thing I remember. That is why I rent from ISP. If it doesn't work, the problem is theirs. Is this an old router? Have you had this router for a while or did you recently get it? If you've had it for more than a couple of years, you may be able to get a free replacement without even any complaint. You can just call them and say, hey, I'm suspicious about my router. Am I qualified to get an upgraded router or new router? Or can I get this replaced because it seems to be interfering with my radio signals? And you just may be able to get a replacement for it. There might be something defective with it. As V Manor says, I'm testing it now. So it sounds like he has some kind of similar setup. Phone jack to modem in on router. Let's see, Chris to Gary. Phone jack on the wall to the modem in the router, then Ethernet from router to computers. Yeah, so I'd want to confirm that when you disconnect the Ethernet from the router, that I suspect you still have the interference, but I'd like to have a confirmation on that. And Chris says it's the same with batteries. So the same with batteries means in the room where the router is, you're running the radio on batteries, unplug, power, the interference from the router, interference goes away. So that means the radio is not picking up the interference through an electrical connection because the radio is not plugged into electrical. However, the interference could still be the electrical wiring in that room putting out a radio signal that's picked up by your FM antenna on the radio. Let's see, same with batteries. Okay, so then, let's see, that's at 5 o'clock. It's any radio I use in my room. Yes, the radio does better in the kitchen. So any radio, meaning this implies that you have other FM radios and they all behave the same way when you bring them into that room, unplug the router, the interference goes away. That is a good piece of information to have. Gary says 6-pin is RJ12. Okay, that makes sense and fits with what you just jarred by memory. I was asking about the kind of jack. That's in reference to earlier question. Does he have filtered DSL? Oh, good question. AT&T and other phone DSL systems used to have filters that you'd have to plug into every other, every unused phone outlet, or every other, actually used or unused. Any other telephone wall jack needs a filter, except for the line that goes from the wall to the AT&T router modem. Now, I don't know if that's still the case with UVerse. Was that just for devices prior to UVerse? Because I've done some UVerse installations and it seems to me those filters are no longer included in the self-install kit. Chris says, I will have to try that, unplugging it later. Okay, gotcha. I had it a couple years. They claim they updated their self. It's from 2018, but could be an older model. I lived in town and had cable for a while, and the cable modem never interfered. So it does, it would update automatically for firmware, but the updates that I've experienced for equipment, it's all been Comcast. So I can't say that I've had the same experience with AT&T UVerse. But if you've asked them, if you've told them you're having troubles or not troubles, I'm not sure if you're having FM reception problems is something they're going to care about. You're going to have to, I think you'd probably be better served to be more vague and ask them, can I swap this out for another one? I have reason to suspect it's not functioning right, and they'll look up your specific device, and if you're qualified for a new one, they'll give it to you. If not, then not. Gary asks where Chris is located. I'm trying to recall if I know that. Can you tell us about that, Chris, where you're located? I guess in the country is what you're talking about, or maybe are you in a rural location? You had to make me pronounce that word, didn't you? Or are you in a city location? Suspect RF interference is from router's power supply. Does it have a brick? There's a good question. Maybe you just replace the power brick. Chris, to Tony Wallow, I was told DSL filter is not needed, but whoever told me could be wrong. You had a good point. The phone cable could be bad or may need a filter. Yeah. The self-install kit or the instructions that came with that modem router, which you probably don't have anymore, would tell you to install filters. If you do a web search for your model of AT&T router, installation instructions, model router, installation instructions, you should be able to find a PDF that tells you whether filters are needed or not. I would rely on that more than I would a phone call to AT&T. Where are we at over here? 95%. He's in Georgia. Chris is in Georgia. That's at 5:05 p.m. Lance says, unplug the router at the wall socket or just the power connection on the router. Well, there's a good partial point. So let's suppose there is a power brick. If you leave it plugged into the wall and just unplug the side connected to the router, if the power brick is emanating radio signals, you should still have the problem. But I think that there's no power flowing through it if it's not plugged into the router. So I'm not confident about that. Blackwatch says no longer needed. I'm sure he's referring to the filters. Tim Sal, yes, you have one with UV. Yes, you have to have one with UV. ultraviolet, UVerse. Yes, you have to have one with UVerse. He's saying you have to have filters with UVerse. Blackwatch is saying no. All right. We're going to have to put them in a ring and they can duke it out. Chris says, yes, they update the firmware. But firmware is not going to cause radio interference. There's got to be something else going on, something physical with the device if it is actually the router. And here's another thing, Chris. Do you know somebody else that has UVerse, especially if they have UVerse internet only without TV? Take your radio over there and see if you get the same interference. That would be a good thing to know. Do all UVerse router modems put out this interference? Then another piece is, do any of your AM/FM radios have antenna connectors that you can connect a better quality antenna and see what difference that makes? I don't know if that's important because, well, especially if you can take your radio to somebody else's UVerse and find you don't have the interference, then we don't care about a different quality antenna. You have multiple AM/FM radios, but are they all kind of old? Could they all be somewhat weak in their, I don't know, radio tuning capabilities? I don't know. Don't be offended, please. Just conversation here. Tim Sal says I had to get one when I was with them. That would be the filter. It was a pain. One went back to Comcast. I think they only have two models of router modems, I suppose. He's in a rural location. It did not come with the filter, and there are no other jack. If you had a self-install kit and it did not come with filters, then filters are not needed. There are no other jacks. Okay, good. This home had no phone jacks. The phone man had to install a jack right through the wall, is the box outside. Does the box outside have the wall? The box outside sounds like it's close to this room. I was going to say maybe there's lack of insulation there, but I'm not a fan of that idea because you unplug the router, that box is still there outside, and you don't have the interference. What brand radio? He has multiple radios. It is what looks to be an inexpensive radio. He shows it on his video. And he had briefly shows the setup of the table and stuff of where his equipment is set up. Chris, is it okay for me to post a link to the video on your channel or even play it? I could just play it right here. It's about 5 or 6 minutes long. Chris says it's not the power brick because when I unplug from the wall, reception gets better. Okay, but what about if you leave it plugged into the wall and unplug the power brick from the router so that the power brick is still plugged into the wall? Does the reception still get better? Now, maybe that's what you were doing previously, and that's why you didn't mention it here. Some filters are in the phone jack on the wall. Yeah, but still, the self-install kit should come with filters because the self-install kit doesn't know that you have filters in your jack on the wall. All right, I'm going to walk away from the desk for a moment. I need to go turn the air conditioner on. 5:14 and I'm at 5:11 in the chat, so I'm not too far behind. All right, so let me get this computer onto the next phase because it has finished creating the flash drive. So click finish. Setup is cleaning up before it closes. So I'm going to restart the computer with the memory stick plugged in. And if this thing works the way I think it should automatically boot to that memory stick. Is it plugged in? Yes, the memory stick is plugged in. The keyboard is not plugged in. Chris says, my phone wires are newer and not copper. They have several wires inside instead of a single copper line. So stranded wires, the phone wires you're referring to. So it's not solid core wire, it's stranded. I don't know if that makes a difference. It's outside of my awareness. Bell Canada, web over copper, no filters are needed now. Gary to Chris, what brand is the radio? 512 or at? Oops, I guess I should. That looks like a Windows 10 boot. We didn't see a brown screen before. Nope, it's not. Okay, so it didn't work. Let's go back. Secure boot, we want to know. If secure boot is on, enabled, then that would mean I am not going to be allowed to boot to USB memory stick, I would think. Oh, keyboard's disconnected. So let that go again. Can another piece of electrical equipment be causing it? So the way to test that would be to shut down everything else, unplug everything else, so the only thing that's plugged in is the AT&T router. That's a good test. I think that would be a good thing for you to try, Chris. Shut down everything else, turn off everything else, disconnect everything else from power, and only have the AT&T router connected without any Ethernet connected, with the radios turned off. I think you're still going to have interference, but I think you should check that out. In that case, could it be that it's a combination of equipment? Now, you talked about harmonics yourself, electrical harmonics. Could it be, and you were thinking electrical harmonics between the router and your radio. How about electrical harmonics between your router and some other device that's in that room that puts out a signal that causes interference for the radio? So that would be what you're targeting by shutting everything else off, disconnecting everything else, and see if you have interference when you only have the radio and the AT&T router. I kind of like that approach. So let's see, I'm trying to get into CMOS setup. And keyboard commands to get to restart and using escape key. Get key for startup menu. All right, BIOS setup is F10. And that password. CMOS setup, admin password. Try it again. There. Oh, I think that's probably an advanced, or actually security. Stop yelling at me, I found it. Set up password, power on password, device security. Of all those saved device available, USB security, the ports. USB port 0, rear USB ports enable. USB port 0 enable, USB port 1 enable, USB port 2 disable. I only saw two USB ports. Well, that's not what I'm looking for right now. Slot security, M.2 card slot is disabled. So it has an M.2 card slot. Yeah, I know that would speed the computer up. We're not spending money on this computer just to speed it up. The residents, all they do is they play these very simple games. Speeding up is going to be pointless for them. Network boot is enabled. I don't need that, but don't really care about it. Family name, system security, virtualization technology is disabled. Secure boot config. Sitting down there at the bottom, all along it said secure boot configuration. If I had that showing to you on the screen, you would have been yelling at me. This is in red. The options on this setup page are only for Windows 8 and other operating systems that support secure boot. Changing the default setting of any of the setup options on this page for operating systems that do not support secure boot may prevent the system from booting successfully. Are you sure you want to continue? That's not really telling me whether secure boot is enabled or not. I would think that this warning wouldn't come up if it was already enabled. So I'm going to say F10 to accept that I do want to continue. Legacy support is disabled. Secure boot is enabled. Key management, clear secure boot keys, don't clear. Key ownership, HP keys, fast boot is enabled. So secure boot is enabled. So I'm thinking that's why it's not booting to the USB memory stick, because that seems like an insecure thing. I don't know this area very well. So I hit spacebar there, that disables it. F10 to accept. F10 again. Change, save changes and exit. Yes. So that memory stick is still plugged in. I'm going to check to make sure it's plugged all the way in. Yeah. So is it going to boot automatically off the memory stick now? Operating system boot mode change. It's changed to the operating system secure boot mode is pending. Please enter the passcode displayed below to complete the change. If you did not initiate this request, press the escape key to continue without accepting the pending change. Interesting. Operating system boot mode change 021. So they want, they got a four-digit number plus the enter key to complete the change or escape without changing. So that code, that number there they have has nothing to do with any of the passwords on this computer. So I'm going to give you a closer view of that screen. Now, some of you may already be aware of this because you've been through this before, but I haven't. Now, the DVR is turned on, so if you want to come back and look at that longer, you can rewind to that and pause the video. You could pause it in a different tab on your browser if you want to continue listening to the video playing in one tab and look back at that screen on another tab. There's no law that says you can't have the same video on two different tabs in your browser. So 9972. Enter. Now nothing is visible on the screen when I type that. Since this was F10 to get into setup, I'm guessing it's probably F9 for choosing a boot device. That's going to be my next thing to try. Although that escape key, I think, probably gave a boot device option. This doesn't look good. I think this is going back into Windows. Yes, it does. And let's see, I'm keyboard only now. So, tab key. To get over to these icons, tab all the way to get to power, enter, down arrow twice to get to restart. So keyboard is active. I'm going to be using escape key to get to startup options. Chris says, I unplugged the brick and it gets better reception. I do not think it's the brick. I don't understand your conclusion. You unplug the brick, it gets better reception. Well, that means the brick is part of the problem. It's a Sony boombox. If you unplug the brick from the wall and you get better reception, is the brick connected to the router at that time? If you've got the brick disconnected from the router, and you still have interference, then you unplug the brick from the wall, that means it is the brick. If the brick alone plugged into the wall gives you interference, then it is the brick. So when you say you unplug the brick and it gets better reception, and you're concluding from that you don't think it's the brick, I don't see how you make that conclusion from that test. Gary says, what video? The video I'm referring to is Chris made a video of the symptom. Chris says, yes, please play it. Awesome. We'll get to that here. All right, let's get this Windows 10 install going. Boot device options is F9 indeed. Setup password. Why don't I just take that password off? So here's my boot options. Windows Boot Manager, SanDisk Cruiser. That is my USB. There's two choices for the network adapter, then there's legacy boot sources. So Windows Boot Manager is going to give me the hard drive. I'm selecting SanDisk Cruiser. Chris, I was unplugging it from the modem, but it does not matter. I still have the problem. Well, Chris, if you unplug it from the modem and you still have the interference, that means it's not the modem, it's the power brick. The way I'm understanding your description here, it is the power brick. Catherine says hello. Hi, Catherine. You can play the video. I'll get to that here. I need to get through this quickly. Did you change the BIOS? Not sure what that's in reference to. Let's get this going. Oops, I don't have mouse, so keyboard to get to next. And install now is highlighted. Enter. I need to try to catch up with this stuff so I can play that video. Crystal Lance, it does not matter. Blackwatch wants some of my cold air. Chris, yes, they are stranded. Oh boy, you're responding to stranded. I must be so far behind. Is there any point for me reading through all of these? Did Chris put up the video? Sorry, Chris, sorry. I will check that again. I think I already tried that. If the brick is unplugged and the noise, William, if the brick is unplugged and the noise is gone, the brick is bad. If it's gotta keep this in mind. Unplug the power from the router with the brick still plugged into the wall and you have noise. Then unplug the brick. Noise is gone. That means it's the brick. And so Chris says he will check the brick. I have unplugged both. I just remembered I unplugged it before I did the video. I have unplugged both. I just remembered I unplugged it before I did the video. Okay, I'm going to go get the video. So, let's get this installation going since that's going to take a while. So again, I don't have any mouse because I have two USB ports. The thumb drive is plugged into one, the keyboard's plugged into the other. I know there's other ways I could work around it. I got a dotted line around accept license terms, so space bar to put a check mark there. Tab key to get to the next button, press the enter key. Then I get the choice of upgrade or custom. I want to go to custom, enter. Then here's all the partitions. So there's a Windows partition and then there's a Macrium backups partition. So I have the Windows partition is 224 gigabytes. The backup partition is 223 gigabytes. So I'm highlighting the Windows partition and the word delete has the letter D underlined. So Alt D, and then it asks me to confirm that. I'll left arrow to get onto the OK, press Enter. So that will delete that Windows partition. So now in place of where that Windows partition was, it now says unallocated space. So right now, when I'm highlighting drive zero partition one, down here it says Windows can't be installed on drive zero partition one. I'm gonna down arrow to get to unallocated space. So now I no longer have an objection here. The letter N is underlined. I'll hold down the Alt key and press the letter N. And then OK is already highlighted. It's got a box around it, so just press the Enter key. Copying Windows files. Okay. Chris says I should have unplugged the brick in the video. It's just hard to get behind an entertainment center. And I'm confused now. Okay, thank you. I'm glad you're saying, Chris, that you're confused now. Because that allows us to make a clean slate of it and start over. Now, another possibility, Chris, it's hard to get back there to the wall to unplug it from the wall. Yeah, I guess that's what you're saying. But maybe the power brick, it can be unplugged from the power line that's coming from the wall. Because some power bricks, you can typically, it's a permanent line that goes to the computer that you can unplug, but that side you can't remove from the power brick. But the actual electrical cable, the AC cable, you should be able to unplug that side from the power brick. So there you effectively have the power brick removed from power. So does the interference go away? All right, so I'm gonna show how I'm gonna get to Chris's video, because this is something many of you probably already know, but you easily might not. So if I come to the video that you're watching and, the chat is, no, I guess I just need the chat. So Chris's channel, if you're able to interact in chat, that means you have a channel and that you can upload videos and either make them unlisted or private or public. You have that capability. If you have any kind of a channel name that shows up when you involved in chat. So Chris's channel name is Chris Garrett. Now it used to be that you could click on the three dot menu and choose an option to go to that person's channel, and YouTube took that away. That no longer happens. You can't click on it anywhere. So we gotta go find Chris's channel. And when we go search for his name, we may find a lot of Chris Garretts. We're looking for the one that has this blue icon, the letter C and a blue icon. So I'm going to come to a new tab on my browser, YouTube, and then going up here to search and type Chris Garrett. I'm going to double check myself on spelling. Let's see, actually, can I copy? Yeah, drag across that, Control C, then Alt Tab to get back here, Control V to paste, Enter. So here's the channel emblem for that channel that came up for Chris Garrett. That's not what we want. And it doesn't even say Chris Garrett. So we're looking one for one that actually says Chris Garrett. And it can be difficult to find someone this way. Oh, Chris Garrett shows up on a Kerry Holzman video. Yeah, when I had this idea how I was going to show you how to find somebody's channel easily, I forgot that that feature is no longer available. So here's an actual Chris Garrett. Oh, you know what? Here's a better way. I'm going to go back up to the top, go over here to filters. And I want to filter for channels. Okay, so Chris Garrett, I don't want Chris Garrett in the name of a video. Where are you? Here. I don't want Chris Garrett in the name of a video like we saw there. So I'm going to say that I only want channels that have the name Chris Garrett. Boom. So we're looking for that one that has the blue C. There it is. One subscriber, 16 videos. Come in here to videos. I don't know. This isn't feeling like it. I don't think that's the right channel. And come back here. Did that icon look right? See, maybe there's another one. Let's see, go back here to Chris Garrett, enter, filters, channel. The reason why I didn't think that was the right one is because I didn't see the video. Now, this is a lowercase c. We know that's not right because Chris Garrett has a capital C. And the color's not right. Let me know in chat, was that the right channel, Chris? Was there some other reason I wasn't seeing the video or maybe just not recognizing? Oh, here. How about this one? See, there's the same looking icon. Two videos. Doesn't say how many subscribers. I'm going to right click and open a new tab because I don't want to have to scroll again to get down to this point. So right click, open a new tab and see if that's the right one. I don't think so. No, because I know he had more than two videos. Neither of those are the right color. That's a lowercase c. That's kind of a purple. I should go check and see if he said anything. Search I386. All right. That's not it. It's under a different name. I386. I could just go to my email and click on the link that he gave me. Duh. Yeah, that's not. That's not doing it either. All right, I'm going to go to the email. I'll let you watch this for a little bit. Okay, I've got it. Oh, I see. The channel name is I386. Oh, so you've got a different name showing. Oh, it's a different channel. Yeah, it's a different channel than what you're interacting with in our chat. So here's the channel name, I386. And that's a totally different icon, but here's the video. So let me contemplate. Okay, so when I play this video, I'm going to mute my microphone so you don't get the echoing. And I think you're going to hear the audio because it should be coming through the connection to the. No, it doesn't. No, because I'm not remotely connected to my computer number two. It's coming through speaker. So I'll leave my microphone on. Yeah, that's it. Let me know in chat how the audio is doing, which means I need to have chat over here. All right. I'm gonna unmute that computer. Here you go.
I will try to explain this in the video the best I can. And here's what's going on. So the reception is bad in this house. Especially when the router is plugged up. The modem router from AT&T. So you can hear a station. I can't play music too much on here, but you can hear a station in the background. But I can almost get the station, but with the router, it also stops. See? It's a dead signal from the router. See how it picks up? See how it does that right there? So I'm going to unplug the router. and I will have the modem and router model number in the description. I have tried to disable the wireless. So it's not the wireless causing the problem. It's actually probably the, I'm thinking it's, I don't know really. But it's not the wireless transmitter that I don't know what it really is. Could be the Ethernet ports or whatever. I don't know. But something's causing the harmonic on the FM band, causing stations not to come in as clear. Because when I unplug it, like you just saw where I unplugged it, I will actually show you. See, there's no light on the router, and it is unplugged. See, I can't pour this cord up much, but that is the cord. So you see that it is unplugged. So anybody has any suggestions, please leave it in the comments. And I could move this modem. I could move it to the living room. I've already got Ethernet cord ran to the living room. I got two Ethernet cords running to the living room, going to the dish network box. But I didn't want so much. I wanted the less you have connected to wireless, the better it is. But I don't know. But I just wanted it connected to Ethernet. So like I said, if anybody has any suggestions, please let me know in the comments. I could try when it gets cooler weather, I could try crawling under the house and move the modem. I would have to run a phone cord, and it has to be I forget what it's called, but it has to be a special kind of cord. I'm going to have to get the phone company to do it, but it has to be a special cord that runs from the jack to the modem. Just any cord won't work. It's a green cord from AT&T, a green phone cord. So if anybody has any suggestions, please leave it in the comment section. Please like and subscribe. And have a great day. Thanks for watching.
Okay, where do I want to go? So I got a one piece of clarification on that. You could clearly see that where Chris is unplugging the router, he's unplugging the power brick from the router. The power brick's still plugged into the wall, and the interference on the radio goes away. And I, from the comments in the chat, I'm thinking maybe some people are misunderstanding. Chris is not having a problem with his computer. He's not having a problem with his internet. The problem he's complaining about is the radio. He wants to be able to hear the FM radio. Now, the best channel I heard in that example was 99.1. I wish that you would have stayed on that 99.1 instead of going up and down the band. I don't know what point that served, because it seemed to me that 99.1 was the only station that you were getting any kind of reception on. The rest, I only heard static. I think I heard a little bit of something on one of the others, but 99.1 was the best one I heard when you had the router disconnected, and it still wasn't very good. I'm hard-pressed to imagine how you get any enjoyment out of that. But I'm assuming that you really, really want that radio to be able to play FM there, as opposed to this just being an academic search. If this is just an academic search, meaning you noticed the FM radio doesn't work there when the router's plugged in, but you never listened to it anyway, then it doesn't matter why even pursue this? So I'm assuming you want to be able to be playing radio stations while you're at that location. So the part about replacing the modem, that's still on my radar. The part about putting a long electrical extension on the router, take it to another room and see if it still has an impact on the reception. That's still on my interest list. Disconnecting the AT&T signal cable from the router to see if that clears up the reception of the radio. That is still a piece I'm interested in. Turning off all the other equipment and seeing if you, if turning off the router still makes that difference. That's still a piece that I think could be useful. Let's see what's going on in chat. And let's show you what's going on here. So I got to move this on. I haven't looked at chat yet. Choosing United States, yes. Let's see, I don't, is there more in chat? Yeah, there is. So as V Manor asks, I do not understand how FM radio relate to router interference. The concern is the radio interference, not worried about the router. Thinking that the router is causing the radio interference. Or maybe your comment about not understanding is that you don't understand how it could be causing interference. And that's the whole, that if that's what you're referencing, then you do understand what we're perplexed about. Come on, I'm trying to select yes for US. Skip keyboard. I don't need that memory stick connected anymore. I can plug in the mouse. Is radio better on AM or FM? How much better? Unplug the radio while... Now, this one I didn't understand. Unplug the radio while being on the PC. Does that resolve it? Yeah, if he unplugs the radio, he no longer has interference on the radio, but he has no radio. The whole point is that he wants better reception on the radio. I don't either, but you see in the video it is. I get a lot of popping on AM unless it's nighttime on the get. I've never got very good reception on those little AM FM radios anytime. And I've had interference at different places in the house. I mean, it seems like a pretty common thing. So that's where my comment comes in about take your radio to somebody else's AT&T setup and see if it has the same problem. Now I'm at the point for adding an account, and I need to get that generic account set up. So I'm going to have to turn my attention away from this radio issue. Oh, yeah, and Chris, about a station broadcasting online, sometimes you want to be old school and listen to the radio. Okay, I understand that. I use TuneIn on my computer to get radio stations even. I do get local radio stations here where I'm at. But still, you're saying that, you know, I was thinking like if you're restarting the computer or doing a variety of things, you might not want to be playing radio stations through the radio. I can believe it. My cousin told me at one time AT&T sent him a new power brick for no reason, so maybe there's a known problem. Could be. Did Chris just hijack this thread? Hijack the video? Well, no, because I was planning to do something with Chris. I've been in communications with him for a little while. So I'm going to drop Chris's issue now. Chris, I hope we've given you some things to think about or work on. We're going to turn back to this project. And it just went to... Oh, it was sitting there waiting for me to sign in, and I didn't do anything. Now it went somewhere else. So let's get rid of the USB drive. Get the mouse back. Add your account. Okay, so what I'll need to do is go find an account to use or create an account. And I may be actually taking you to the admin panel for Microsoft 365 for this client. Oh, I've got to remember what we have here. Okay, yeah. So, to administer Microsoft 365, it's office.com, which I love the way they set this up because that's the same address you put into if you want to go into your Microsoft 365 online account. Then I can do sign in over here, but I seem to find that if I do sign in over here, it populates the accounts that I've used before, which I can't show you that. So go to camera three. And here, this computer is only showing me the one account, and that's the wrong account. So I'm going to go grab the administrator account credentials for this office. It's this username, so I highlight that, press Control-C to copy. Then I highlight the password, Control-C to copy. And then Alt-Tab to get back to that page. Then Windows key V to select from my pasteboard clipboard history to choose the account name and click Next. And then I'm going to Control A to highlight that password, even though I think it's remembering the right password. Windows key V and click on the password. Then click Sign In. And then it asks me if I want to stay signed in. I'm answering no, because if I do that, I find it's kind of difficult to sign in with a different account. So here I get all of the documents that have recently been used from this administrator account, which one of the management people in this office actually uses this account. And then down here in the bottom left, there's an icon with the letter A. That's the admin portal. So when I click on that, that takes me into the administrator portal. None of the other accounts for this office are going to take me in to the, it's not even going to have that option for admin. So then I come over here to users up here and click on active users. And this shows all of my active users. And I want an account here for residents. And all of these are staff accounts. So I'm going to click up here for add a user. And the first name for that, how do I want to do this? Okay, I'm going to use a two-letter abbreviation of the facility, and the last name will be the word resident. And when I press the tab key, it defaults to combining those two names to be the display name. And then for the username, I'm going to use the same thing, the two letters and the word resident. And it automatically has the domain name. Then it has an option here to automatically create a password. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to create the password because there may come occasion where I need to provide that password to a staff person. So I'll come back to my OneNote for that office. I'm on the Office 365 tab. I'm going to add a new username down here. Call it MT Resident. And then I go to another place to put in a coded password. I want something that is secure, but that I can read off to somebody, and so that it kind of makes sense to them. All right, then I'm going to come to a new browser tab and show you this. Go into a site, how secure is my password.com. I believe it's a .com. Oh, .net. How secure is my password.net? And then I have that currently copied into the clipboard, so I'm going to press Control V to paste that in here. So this password is 2 million years for a brute force hacking. I'm going to add one character to that, 200 million years. That's better. Take a quick look and see, was there anything else? Let's see, Chris says my cousin has the same router modem. Bad radio reception. Okay, I'm going to have to let you run with whatever you've seen in there, Chris. No power brick. Okay, I guess I have seen everything there that has me named. And Chris, you're welcome for the help. And please let me know how it goes. See if you find something. Let's see, and you said you've had that for a couple of years, I think. And have you always had this problem with that reception, or did the reception used to be good? Yeah, I don't think I ever saw an answer to that. If you did answer it, I didn't see it. Doug, you still on char overload? Just kidding. Char. Probably the answer is that to that is yes, but it is, because I can't think of what the word char means, I think that tells you my brain is turning to mush. So yeah, let's wrap this up. Thank you everybody for being here. I hope this has been an enjoyable endeavor, and see if this is something that I want to continue doing some more, meaning turning on live stream while I'm doing actual work. And there's the email address if you want to reach out to me for doing a session on Zoom and live stream and so on. Doug at LiveWindowsTraining.com, and that'll do it. So I hope this was useful. Have a great day. Catch you later. Goodbye.